Namaste student, we are in the chapter, sixth chapter, that is staffing, and it is the last topic in that particular chapter, that is nothing but training and development. The topic, that is training and development. So this is the last topic in the sixth chapter staffing. Now, in the previous session, we discussed about the process of or the procedure for the selection. What and all process are there? What and all tests we need to conduct? There we initially we screen the application, then we conduct variety of tests, and we conduct variety of interview process to in order to select a person. Now, after selecting a particular candidate or a particular person for a particular job, what we need to do? Now, when we select a person, he may not be having all the skill and knowledge which we require, or else he might be having skill and that what skill he is having, it is not sufficient for in our organization to work. It is not sufficient. So what we have to do, we have to provide with the proper training in order to develop their skill and ability. So next topic it is, that is training and development. Now what is that training and development? Now, training is any process by which the attitude, skills and abilities of employees to perform specific jobs are improved. So, training is any process by which attitude, skill, what is that attitude? Attitude is nothing but how a person is going to behave or how a person is going to react. What is his characteristic? So, that says the attitude. So, attitude, skill and abilities is skill of completing the task, or is skill of managing a particular situation, and abilities, whether he has a ability to complete this task, or if we provide something new, whether he has the ability to grasp it. Abilities of employers to perform specific jobs are improved. So what is the main objectives? Our objective is to improve what he has already. That we have to improve, or else if he doesn't have such tech skill, we have to provide it. So this is the process of training. Now, after providing the training here, now it should provide something to employees, and also it should provide something to the organization. Why we need to provide training? What are the importance of training? Now, importance means, now when we select a person, he will surely he'll be a qualified from particular professional institution, he'll be a qualified. Now whether he will get a knowledge which is required for the organization, yes, he will get a knowledge or he will get a skill, but it will be in a theoretical form. But what he has to do in the organization, he has to apply practically. What theoretical skill he studied over there, or what theoretical skill he gained in that particular institution or professional courses, that skill or knowledge he has to apply practically here. So before applying skill or knowledge practically, what we have to provide them are proper training. Then they will get to know how I have to apply what I have studied theoretically, where I should apply it. So directly, without providing proper training to them, directly if we put them into a particular task or particular work, then everything will get ruined there. Their work also get spoiled there, and their confidence also there, it gets spoiled. So for that purpose, we have to provide them with the proper training. And if we provide training, what kind of benefits are there or importance of training? So if we come towards the importance of training, we divide it into two categories, that is importance or benefits to the organization, and here benefits to the employees, benefits to the organization and employees. So firstly we'll go with the benefits to organization. Now here, first one, it reduces wastage of effort and money. What happens if we provide a training? If we provide a training, a person or the candidate, he learn, or else he will get to know how to work or how to carry this particular operation. So he knows to work. When he knows to work, what happens? It reduces the wastage. Wastage might be not only in case of effort and money. Obviously, wastage of effort and money. It might be a resources, many kind of resources we use. The financial resources, that what we call money. or else other kind of material resources which we are using in the organization. It will not get waste if he knows to utilize it properly. And effort, how effort will be reduced? If he know this particular work, he will complete it with a short period of time. If he doesn't know to work, then he takes a longer period of time. So if we provide them with the proper training, it reduces the wastage of effort and also money. Then next, if we see, it increases production in both quantitatively and qualitatively. It helps to increase the production. How it helps to increase the production? Now, if a person, if we provide proper training to him, then he will be an efficient person. Or what do you mean by efficient? Efficient means the best way of doing particular job with less effort and time. If you become efficient, then obviously there will be increase in case of production. Yes, we want to increase our production, but in what case or in what terms? We want to increase production quantitatively. In case of number of units also, it should increase. At the same time, we have to maintain the quality. So quality is very, very important factor which gives our image to a particular organization, or which gives goodwill to the particular organization. It is a very, very important factor for any of the organization. They have to maintain the quality in their product, what they are serving to the society. They have to maintain the quality. So here it helps if we provide training to our employees. It helps to increase the production in both quantitatively, in case of number, in terms of number, and also in case of quality. They will maintain the quality. Employees will maintain the quality because they know how to maintain the quality or how to carry the work. That is second one. Then it creates the future manager. See, as I said, when we were discussing about the sources of recruitment, there are two sources are there. One is internal sources of recruitment and one more is external sources of recruitment. Internal sources of recruitment, they mainly we have come across with the promotion and training. And their training, training and transfer. Why we transfer the employees? We transfer the employees sometimes for the purpose of training. The person is working in a production department. We are transferring that person to a finance department. After some time, we are transferring that person to a marketing department. Or after some time, human resource department. Why? Because we want him to learn all the activities of the organization. We want to project him as a future manager. Or future, we require one efficient person as a manager. So we want to prepare him for that particular position. So in order to prepare him for that particular position, he should possess all the knowledge. In the sense, he should be knowing all the operations of the organization. So we are transferring him to one department, other department, so that we are providing training. So it improves the for the purpose of creating a future manager, we provide the training. Which kind of training? As I said, we are transferring him to one department to other department. That is for the purpose of to create him as a future manager. And the next one, it improves the employee's morale. It is also a very important factor. It has to improve their employee's morale. What happens if a morale or value system? Morale is nothing but value system of a person. If a value system of a person, if it increases, what happens? There will not be absenteeism, or there will not be the possibility of labor turnover. They will be punctual in their work, and they will maintain the discipline in the workplace, which is very, very important for the interest of organization also, and for the peace of the employees also. They improve the employees' morale. So if employees' morale, if it increases, then there will not be labor turnover or absenteeism in the organization. Then to cope up with the changes. This is very, very important. Cope up with the changes. What is the changes? You all know that we work in a dynamic environment or a situation. Dynamic environment is nothing but which environment is keeps on changing. Keeps on changing is mainly with the technology. What happens? Today what technology will not be there, it will get old very very with a very limited period of time another technology will arise in the market. So we have to cope up with such kind of technology. So what we need to do, we have to train ourselves and we have to update ourselves. If we update ourselves, then only we can adjust with that coming technology and we can run a business. So to cope up with the changes is nothing but mainly in case of technological changes. As we work in a dynamic situation, technology will be, it will be keeps on changing. So we need to adjust with that, or we have to grasp it and we have to run our business. For that purpose, we have to provide proper training to our employees. Then only they can cope up with the changes. What happens if they fail to cope up with the changes? Then we lose our position in the market. If you fail to cope up with the technology or the changes, means we fail to cope up with the market. For example, you see, we can say, take the example of Nokia phones. What happens when smartphones had come in the market? They did not cope up with that change, that technological change. So they lost their place in the market in case of smartphones. So such kind of problems will happen for the business or organization. So we have to cope up. In order to cope up, we have to train our candidates or employees properly. So these are the benefits to organization, that it reduces the wastage, it reduces the wastage of effort and money, and it increases the production in case of qualitatively as well as quantitatively. It creates the future manager. For the purpose of, in order to create future manager, we have to provide a proper training so that they should get the knowledge of all the activities. Then it improves the employee morale, that is nothing but value system, where there will be less labor turnover or absenteeism in the workplace. And to cope up with the rapid changes, or to adjust with the rapid changes. Then we'll see the benefits to the employees. What kind of benefits employee will gain personally? For him, what kind of benefits he will get from training, if he get a proper training? Then the first one, to improve their skill and knowledge. The mainly for the purpose of improve his skill and knowledge. What happens if we improve his skill and knowledge? Skill and knowledge, if we improve, not only for this organization, wherever if we go also, it will be with him. So it will provide a great help for that particular individual or the employees. Wherever if we go also, it will have help, whatever, what kind of skill he gained through training in this organization, or what knowledge he gained, or what he improved. So it helps him to get a skill and knowledge about work. Then increasing performance. As I said, there will be increasing production. Increasing production means how they can increase the production. If they perform better, if they perform better, then only we can increase the production. So it helps to increase their performance, because they get efficient in work. So if they are efficient, means obviously their performance will go high. It helps them to give better performance or to provide better performance. Third one, it makes employees more efficient to handle machines and equipment. It is very, very important in case of machines and equipment. What happens if a person, if we do not provide training to a person who is going to work with machines and equipment, there may be the possibility of breakdowns of such kind of machine, and which leads huge loss for that organization, or something happens to that person while handling it. That's also a loss for the organization. So we cannot provide machines and equipment to a newly joined employees. We have to give him a training. What kind of training we provide in case of this, that we are studying further, there are some training methods and techniques are there. So we have to provide proper training those who handles machines and equipment. Otherwise, it leads some other kind of problem for the organization as well as for that candidate or the person who is going to handle it, machines and equipment. So it makes employees more efficient. They will, through training, they will learn how to handle the machines and equipment. So it will be helpful for them to handle machines and equipment. then it increases their satisfaction and morale. As I said, it increases their morale. Morale means their value system. There will be punctual in the workplace and there will be reduction in the labor turnover, and as well as they will be knowing how to behave or how to react in the workplace. And satisfaction, what is that satisfaction? As I said, if we work in a place, if we work in the sense, if we work properly, if we work properly, and if our organization, there will be increase in the production, and at the same time our increasing performance, means obviously it will give great kind of satisfaction for individually for that particular person. So it helps him to get work satisfaction as well as through his morale or value system in the workplace. So these are the benefits, or we can call it as these are the importance of the training to employees as well as to the organization. In case of employees, there are to improve their skill and knowledge and to increase the performance. It makes employees more efficient to handle machines and equipment, and it increases their satisfaction and morale. And now there are some techniques, or there are some methods. We were speaking about training. Now what kind of training we provide? How the employees will get trained? Whether they are trained in the workplace itself, or we are sending them to some other place to get trained. So next we will see the methods of training. There are two kinds are there, on the job and off the job. Now next we will see the methods of training. When we speak about methods of training, there are two kinds, in a two way we can train our employees, that is on the job training and off the job training. Here the name itself, on the job training, means we are providing training to our employees in the workplace itself, where they are working there only. By doing their regular work, by doing their regular work only, they are learning how to work. That is, we call it as on the job training. And off the job training means off the job. The name says that off the job means they will not be in their actual workplace. They are sent to some other place in order to get trained. After getting that particular training which is required for that employee, then he will come back to the workplace and then he continues his work. So there are two methods, on the job training and off the job training. Now we'll see one by one. On the job training, what are the training techniques, and off the job training, what are the different ways of providing training. Now if we speak about on the job training, apprenticeship training. What is that apprenticeship training? It is in case of skilled and semi-skilled work. This kind of training we provide in case of skilled and semi-skilled work. Like for example, here what happens in the sense, the person who want to learn job, he goes with his senior. He goes with his senior, and with him, by serving him or by working as his assistant, he will learn the job, how to carry this kind of work. Mainly, for example, we can take it as electrician or plumbers or carpenters, the painter. These people, usually if you observe with them, some assistants will be there, like a junior, one assistant will be there. Actually, it is like this kind of training, we call it as apprenticeship training. Here what happens? They go with that senior, their employee, and with them they will work as an assistant, or they initially they will be assisting. By assisting them, assisting the senior, they will learn how to carry this particular kind of work. Then they will learn to work. Then they can become an independent particular professional. It's like a independent, the separate the carpenter or the plumber, he can become. Initially, such kind of training we call it as apprenticeship training. Now, second one, coaching. What is this coaching? Coaching means under one particular coach or as employee, the other 15 to 20 member they will assign. One coach will be there, he will be the senior employee, and among in his supervision or in his guidance, there will be a 15 other employees, newly appointed employees. Now this coach, what he has to do? He has to tell them how to work. He has to teach them how to work, how to carry this particular work or other work. With them, under his guidance, they will start their work. Under his guidance, they will start their work. By working under his guidance, they will learn how to carry this particular work. That is a one more method under on the job training. Now third one, internship. training. What is that internship training? It is mainly in case of the professional courses like lawyers or doctors or chartered accountants, mainly in these professional courses. After completing their the qualification, after completing their courses, there will be a particular period will be assigned to them. It might be a 1 year or it might be a 6 months. What they have to do? They have to go to, if a doctor means he has to go to any of the hospital, a lawyer means he has to work under any senior lawyer, or chartered accountant means he has to go to any of the auditing or financial companies he has to go. So what that student has to do? He has to work for a particular period of time in that particular place in order to get the practical knowledge of that of his particular profession. In order to get the practical knowledge of his particular profession, he has to work for a particular period of time under a particular institution. So there he will get the practical knowledge how to carry the work. He is not the, he will not be the employees of that particular institution or organization. He will go for his study purpose in order to get the practical knowledge. But he will be paid with the amount. That amount we cannot call it as salary. Salary we can say, if they are employees, then we use the word salary. We pay them some amount of money, that we call it as stipend. That we call it as stipend. Those who come for the internship purpose, for them, for their work, we pay some amount, that we call it as stipend. So it is one more kind of training. They will work in a workplace. They will work in a workplace in order to get a practical knowledge about their study, for their study. That is internship. Then next one, job rotation. As I said, job rotation means in case which kind of training. If you want to prepare one particular employee for the post of manager, so we use this kind of training method. What we do? We rotate his place. He will be in a production department. Then we, after sometimes we rotate him or we put him in a financial department. Then after sometimes we put him in a marketing department. Why do we rotate his job? In order to get the knowledge of various kinds of work, we rotate that particular employees. If he gets the knowledge of all the activities of the organization, then what happens? His knowledge and skill will be increased. So we can project that person as a future manager. We can see in the place of future, that person in the place of future manager. So that is job rotation. So these four are the on the job training, means we provide training in the workplace itself by carrying the actual work. They will be doing the actual work, what they have to do under someone's guidance, but they will be in the workplace itself. So these four methods comes under on the job training. Now we'll see what is that off the job training. Off the job training means what happens? These are the methods of off the job training. We send them to some other place. There they will get the training, then they will come to an actual workplace and they start their work. First one, classroom lectures and conference. What is this classroom lectures? For example, if we take lecturers as, we sometimes we go for a conference we go, or some of the workshops, we have workshop, we go to some other colleges. What will be there? Then some other senior professionals will come. They will teach if any kind of changes takes place in related to a subject. We'll sit in a classroom and any senior lecturer or professors will be there. They will elaborate that changes, or they will teach how to make changes with this new kind of changes. You have to, how to learn this or how to solve it. That they will teach. So there we will learn what is necessary in order to carry our work. Then after that we come to our workplace, then continue with our work. That is classroom lecture or conference, where we go like workshops or conference we go. That we call it as classroom lectures. Then films. Films are nothing but it is a documentary films which teach what is the policy procedures of your job, and how to carry this particular work, what kind of work it is. So it gives description about your job through films like it's a like a documentary films about your particular job, not about any other kind of entertaining films. Then case study. See, case study is a written description. You will get a one written description about some particular problem. The written description in the form of writing, you will get one particular problem. That problem might have happened in the organization where you are joined, that organization problem, or it might have happened in some other organization in the past. Then you will get the written description about some problem which happened in the past. Now what you have to do with that case? You have to analyze that case, that what is the actual problem, what happened in the in this particular situation, why this problem created in this particular organization, what kind of solution you might have provided. If you would be in that position during that time, what solution you might have provided. So that we call it as case study. You have to analyze that case, then you have to provide with the solution. By seeing your solution, they will understand what kind of person you are, how you will analyze a particular problem, what kind of solution you can give if this kind of problem, if it arises in the future in front of you. So for that purpose you will get the case study, you have to analyze it. Then computer modeling. Here through software you will get trained, that we call it as computer modeling. About your work, the detailed description about your work, they will create in a software. Through that software you will get proper training. Vestibule training. This is in case of machines and equipment. As I said, it is very very important in case of machines and equipment, because it will bring huge loss to the organization also if something happens, and that particular person also. So vestibule training is, you will be sent to some other place where you have to learn how to handle machines and equipment with dummy machines and equipment. You will be taught, or you will be taught there how to handle the machines and equipment with the dummy machines. Then after learning how to handle that machines and equipment, you will come to an actual workplace and you will carry your work. This is in case of those who are handling machines and equipment. So this is about the methods of training, on the job training and off the job training. In case of on the job training, 4 methods, and off the job training there are 5 methods. These methods may come for practical oriented also. Last 5 mark question, practical oriented, this question may come on the job and off the job training. These are very very important. So with this we ended with the chapter called staffing, 6th chapter. Initially we studied what is staffing, what are the importance of staffing, and staffing as a part of human resource management. Then procedure of staffing, what are the steps included in the staffing. Then we come across the each step in detail. That is, first one we come across recruitment, what are the process of internal sources of recruitment, external sources of recruitment. Then we learned about selection, what are the procedure of selection, what kind of what kind of interviews you have to conduct, what kind of test you have to conduct. And last topic is there is training and development. So with this we are winding up with the 6th chapter. Then next chapter we'll see, that is about diving. So thank you.